Cut crash for the 54 after getting that lucky break. And the BMWs, well, their winning run is coming to an end. It dominated the first part of last season. It looks like it's not going to be there Long Beach this time, I'm afraid. For those guys we've just been talking about, it's been simply imperfect this weekend.
Can you see Chris Tyson, he's not getting around that hairpin particularly well. He's losing a bit of speed in the middle of the corner and not able to get on the path quite as quickly as he'd like. But yeah, at this stage, yeah, he's running in second place. He's confident, he's comfortable there, I'm sure, and he just wants to bring the car home right here. But this battle here, this is very much ongoing. Scott Sharp, we're right on board with him now, going through the fountain section, and he's all over the back of the Corvette. He once passed, he was ahead of the Corvettes before, or right after the mid-race full course caution. He fell behind him, and now has he got an opportunity here as the Corvette slips a little bit wide, and they're side by side there. But of course now the Corvette has the inside line here for the left-hander at turn six.
Oh, I thought the Ferrari had gone straight on there for a moment. Now this is a difficult corner, downhill, the camber doesn't help you on the exit, there's no room on the run out there. This is what we wanted to see. GT cars, street-based Grand Tourers on the streets here at Long Beach. And that is what Jan Magnussen's seeing on his rear-view camera, because that's what they have in that car.
They do an HD camera on the back to give them the pictures onto the dash area of that car. But, you know, his heads-up driving there, he made a little bit of a mistake going into turn five. For two corners in a row, he had the Scott Sharp Ferrari alongside him, but each time Jan Magnussen made sure that the Ferrari was on the outside as it turned into the corner. So advantage Corvette.
Nothing between them as far as engine performance is concerned. We talk a lot about balance of performance, and I get more tweets at Specutainment and Radio Le Mans on the Midweek Motorsport Listeners Collective about that than anything at all. And yet, you know, you look at that and it seems that the Corvette, they've had a few breaks over the years, and the 458, which is a newer car, perhaps not quite as blessed by the rules makers, but there's not much between them there, is there?
And as we saw earlier on when we were on board with the BMW and the Corvette, again, very little to choose between those two either. So I think, yeah, the rules makers have got it pretty equitable here in GT, and as a result of that, we've seen absolutely spectacular racing. Porsches haven't had things their own way this day. The best of them is Wolf Hensler in fifth place, and we saw the Flying Lizard car had a problem earlier on.
And you can hear the frustration in Scott Sharp's voice over what they've had to deal with since they got these Ferraris for Extreme Speed Motorsports. They certainly did not have the result they wanted at Sebring, finishing 12th, but he said, you know what, hey, here we're really, really good in those fast corners and under braking. He was concerned, however, about their straight line speed, but he was really insistent, we need to get at least a podium here and sort of break the cycle.
Yeah,
I think we can see that he's not losing anything on the straight line there to the Corvette.
Okay.
Yeah, and the Corvette there, yeah, without that, without the hood on the car, yeah, that's certainly got a compromise aerodynamics on that car.
Well, they've been having push understeer all weekend with that car. They're running the different sidewalls on the bigger tyres on the GT cars for this race to give a little bit more compliance in the sidewalls, as we heard Kelly telling us earlier on the Michelins. And losing the front end, that'll rob them of some front end downforce. Got damage there as well. The channel air up over the front of the engine, and if you see when we get the front on shot, the engine's pushed well back, and the channel air up through the front grille of the car and then out through the slots in the hood, the bonnet, to push that front end of the car down onto the road more. Now, without that bonnet there, Jan Magnussen is not getting that, so he won't be getting the bite from the front tyres, and that understeer, that push that he was getting into the corners and through the middle of the corners is going to be even worse than ever. Now, the 007 and the 17 having a battle as well, with Wolf Hensler and Adrian Fernandez. They're scrapping over fifth position.
Adrian's doing a nice job. He's actually set a faster time in that car than did Darren Turner in the first stint. So, you know, we talked about earlier, here's Adrian Fernandez looking to the outside as Wolf Hensler defends the inside line going into the corner. But is that going to, again, give Adrian an opportunity to get past him? Not here, it's not.
So, left-hand side of the screen, left-hand side of the screen, the battle between the Corvette and the Ferrari in GT.
For third and fourth.
For third and fourth, and for fifth and sixth on the right-hand side, between Porsche and Aston Martin. Corvette, Ferrari, Porsche, Aston Martin. What's the matter with GT racing? Nothing at all.
No, absolutely love it.
And you couldn't get more, you know, you couldn't get much more different cars. The 911 engine at the back, the front engine V8 Aston Martin, front engine V8 American Muscle of Corvette, and the mid-engine Italian Stallion of the Ferrari. And they're all battling on the streets here of Long Beach. With what, that's 10 minutes to go?
What a good job Adrian Fernandez doing. He's looking again here down the inside of Wolf Henson, not quite close enough to make a move at turn six, but you know, he's been talking quite a bit lately, Adrian, about, you know, his transition to GT racing. You see, it wasn't anything he'd necessarily planned, but he's relishing the challenge. You know, he's a racing driver. He'll drive anything. And yes, he'd probably rather be in a prototype car, but this is the cards that he's been dealt, and he's going to make the most of them. And he's enjoying this challenge of getting to grips with driving a GT car. And as I said, he's done a really, really nice job, because a couple of laps ago, he turned the best lap for this car in the race, a 122 flat, which is, you know, in contention. The other contenders in GT are doing high 20s primarily. The only exception to that, Oliver Gavin, who did that 120.1, and his teammate, the guy with whom he shares that car, Tommy Milner, did 20.4 earlier on.
I think was Gav not down into a 19? Did he not get into a 19?
No.
No, okay.
Not yet.
The
V8 Vantage, it's the early stages of relative development with that car. It's a new car for this season.
Yeah.
Their primary focus is going to be the World Endurance Championship.
He's got a run on the right-hand side of the screen. That Aston Martin
did the same there last lap as well. Kenny died down room, inside. He's going to have a look this
There's
time.
There's not enough room there,
Adrian. Yes, there is.
Wow, he made the room. There wasn't enough room, and Adrian, there was no door open there. He prized it open with the front of the Aston Martin.
He did.
Clean as a whistle, though.
Perfect pass. He snuck it down the inside. He got that car absolutely down the inside under braking. It was decisive by Adrian Fernandez. And Wolf Henson really had no option but to give up the corner at that stage. Great driving by both guys there.
Agreed. And when we talk, as we do, Jeremy, about people giving each other racing room, we're not expecting people to turn and give the inside of the corner easily.
Right.
We're just making sure that there's no need for people to touch, and that's exactly what we saw there. That was hard. Wolf didn't give up the corner easily. Right. Didn't make it easy for Adrian. Wow. Into the pit lane for the P2 leader, and that is Martin Plowman in the number 37. Look at this. It looks like the Ferrari's got a run on Magnussen as well for that battle we were watching for third position. And he's made it stick as well. It's all come alive in the last 8 minutes.
Yeah, and I don't know why the number 37 car is on pit lane, because the Conquest Endurance, what a fabulous job they have done. They changed the engine in that car since Sebring from the Judd to the Nissan. They come in with hardly any testing time, and here they are. Watch this.
Oh, throws the dummy to Magnussen, coming down to seven. Look how wide he's done it. He's going to do the cutback. Magnussen struggling with those front tyres now. Tries to get the power on, but his goose, I'm afraid, is already cooked at that point from the onboard.
Yeah, brilliant there. And look at that. This is a classic move by Scott Sharp. Hats off to Scott Sharp. Perfect move. That is how you make you pressure somebody into a mistake, effectively, because Jan Magnussen there got overly defensive. You could see Sharp fainted to the inside line. He made Magnussen stay to the inside line, because you cannot move to defend your position after somebody else has made a move, but you can if you're attacking, and that's exactly what Scott Sharp did. Fainted to the inside, committed Magnussen to the inside, then Sharp moved to the outside to get that run, that better line through the corner, get the exit, and have the straight line speed that carry on to Seaside Way and make the move.
And the zero
drive.
Yeah. And remember, this car started from ninth position on the grid. Johannes van Overbeck, the birthday boy, got it up to the lead. And now his teammate has pulled it through. Scott Sharp with another great move. And that Whole race performance earns it the Battery Tender Hard Charger of the Race Award for Long Beach. Well done, guys. Thoroughly well deserved. Kept us right on the edge of our seats. And look at the way Sharpie is pulling away. He's only got 5 seconds between himself and second place, you know. And if he's hanging on to the tyres, that Ferrari is notoriously light on its loafers as far as the tyre wear is concerned. And the BMWs both have been damaged. It may well be that the splitter damage on the second place car, well, there it is, it's looking okay. But I tell you what, Sharp is eating into that lead already.
Yeah.
He could be getting second.
He could be, couldn't he? He certainly have, he's got the hammer down now. He's going to try and close that, close down that gap. The best lap that Scott has done in that car, I don't know, he did 21.1 last time around. We'll see what the lap time is when he comes across this time. The best that car has done is a 20.3. That was on lap 58. So that was, I think, that was after the pit stop, certainly. So Scott Sharp has gone faster than did Johannes van Overbeck in the first stint. And Scotty now, is he's got his head down, he's chasing after that BMW for second place in GT.
21-1 last time around for Scott Sharp. That tells you all you need to know. Oh, that's a shame. It's been a reasonably quiet but decent run for the 24 car, and that's ended up, I'm afraid, it's the classic Porsche problem. The left front has come into contact with the wall, and Bob Fayette in the competition motorsports Porsche has bust the front of the... he's gone straight on at the hairpin. Look at the lock-up lines there. He's bust the front radiator left-hand side. That car does not need to go anywhere.
Very careful in turn 11.
Now, that was not his... There's water everywhere, so he's got to be careful. And the radio you heard there was not his teammate manager. I think that was the leader's team manager. It's the classic Porsche thing. The coolers are right in the front. See, he should have stuck with the air cooled. Now, earlier on, we saw the 37 of Martin Plowman, Conquest Nissan, into the pit lane. That's handed the lead of P2 into the hands of Christophe Boucher behind the wheel of the 055 P2 car.
That is the car that won the P2 class at Sebring, so looking to maintain its maximum score here. Level 5 Motorsports, Christophe Boucher and Scott Tucker. It was Scott Tucker that started that car. He had a bit of a mishap early on, didn't he? But he's got that car back up into contention, and Christophe Boucher has taken advantage of an extra couple of extra pit stops for the number 37 car of Conquest Endurance.
In the other classes, GT, still Ollie Gavard leading by 9 seconds. Scott Sharp had a slow lap last time. No, he didn't. If he had a 21.4, still quicker, yeah.
3 seconds a gap between second and third in GT.
I think he's going to run out of time. If this had been 2 hours 45, would have been a different race. It's Damien Faulkner leading for the Green Hornet team in GTC by almost 5 seconds. In PC, it is the 06 of Ryan DL still, as it has been. Haven't talked about those guys so much, but third overall, that's going to be, they've beaten all of the P2 cars. Memo Gidley in second.
Most of the P2 cars have beaten themselves.
Well, that's very true, very true. It will be the final lap for the Muscle Milk ARX Honda the next time around.
Interesting development at Dyson Racing. Earlier, when both the 20 and the 16 car made their only pit stop, they both made it at the same time. The number 20, though, just had to come back to pit lane for a splash of fuel. So that tells you how close it's going to be for that number 16 car.
Yeah, 23 seconds the gap now between Klaus Graf and Chris Dyson. I think they've been on an economy run since Chris got in the car. And really, when we talk about no margin for error, well, they took the wrong choice today.
It's funny you should say that, though, because was it an error for the number 6 car when they came in for that what should have been perhaps their only pit stop? It was a long stop. They probably had to come in again, but the choice was made easier for them because they'd lost the lead. Really nothing to lose by coming and making that splash and go. So was it an error that came out in the favour? Well, maybe we'll find out afterwards. There is the white flag, though, for Klaus Graf. Just less than 2 miles to go now for the Muscle Milk Honda HPD team.
you can't help but say that I like a lot of people up and down this pit lane. It's a very friendly pit lane, but you've got to say this is a good result for these guys. They were robbed of a fantastic result at Sebring last time out with that bizarre failure from the fuel rig. No such problems today on a street circuit that means everything is unforgiven. Both drivers have driven perfectly. Look at the car. It's dirty. Yes, it's got a bit of rubber on it that it's picked up from things being thrown at it. Yes, but it's got all its dive planes. It's got all of its decals. And more importantly, it's not had a single ding all the way around. They've stayed out of trouble. They didn't get all of the brakes. But as Jeremy says, when there's no margin for error, sometimes you've got to change your game plan.
Yes, indeed. That's exactly right. And there was Chris Dyson there, again, just nursing that car home, trying to coax it to the finish line on the fuel he has on board, that Lola Mazda. But here is now Klaus Graf, just a couple of corners to go, John.
Klaus Graf with the yellow flags flying at the final corner for that stranded GTC Porsche, I presume. Yeah, don't give
great
us...
Great job, buddy, great job. We didn't make it easy for you, and you did an awesome job, pal. Thanks.
We didn't make it easy for you.
The race engineer. Look at Greg Pickett.
I think Greg Pickett is mildly excited.
Yeah. He's won himself here on the streets of Long Beach.
Trans Am. Yeah, he has.
A long, long time ago. I think I was here.
Oh, great stuff. Now, in GT, Ollie Gavin took this race by the scruff of the neck just after half distance. And the man from the little village in Northamptonshire, Yardley Hastings, is going to take this one for Corvette and break the BMW winning streak that started at Sebring.
And it's fantastic.
It's just one race this year. Remember, BMW ran away with the first half of the season last year. It's not going to be like that in the GT category now.
And our hats off both to Ollie Gavin and Tommy Milner, who drove a brilliant opening stint in that car. And Oliver Gavin brings it home.
In PC, Ryan DL will come through in third position overall and win the PC category. And in GTC, it's Damien Faulkner by just 3 seconds in the Green Hornet. Somewhere there's a car park down there that has my gear in it, I hope. It's still there anyway. Be nice to take the yacht home. There we go then, the second round of the American Le Mans series for 2000. And are we in 2012 now? Yes, we are. It's the Muscle Milk Pickett Racing Team ahead of the two Dysons. Not the best day for the 20 car. They finished well down, just inside the top 15 in 15th position. And can't quite decide, and maybe we'll find out whether it was great planning by the Muscle Milk guys or bad luck by the Dyson. Or maybe the other way around. It was a strange race that didn't play as we expected. Let's talk to the leaders.
For the second year in a row, Klaus Graf brings his Muscle Milk car into victory circle here at Long Beach. Klaus, you and Lucas each had to make a move on track, but there was also a fuel strategy call made. So where does credit belong for this win?
Well, I think the credit belongs to the whole team. I mean, it was really difficult to find or to put a setup on the car. We couldn't look for it because there was no dry running. So it was hard for everybody involved, PD, Michelin, and everybody provided great performance. So we had great tires from Michelin, and which is very important here on these street circuits. And I mean, both Lucas and I had to push very hard and to make it up to the front. And certainly wasn't easy, but a great day for Massenburg, unbelievable. And I'm very happy to win this race back-to-back. This is a big race in the United States, and I'm very happy to win it again.
All right, congratulations.
Thank you.
In GT, the street fight, well, not perhaps as we expected, not at the front of the field, certainly, but for the minor positions, was hot and heavy as expected. Milner and Gavin win it from the BMW of Hand and Muller and Scott Sharp.
And it's the
third
first American Le Mans Series victory for the driver combo of Tommy Milner and Oliver Gavin. Oliver, how much of a team effort was this win today?
Oh, it was a massive team effort. I mean, it was all about the car coming off the truck, and the guys at Corvette Racing did an amazing job with that. I want to thank Chuck and Brian and Doug Louth and all those guys at Corvette Racing did an amazing job. And of course, I want to thank Tommy. Tommy, my teammate, drove in a brilliant first stint in this car. And the Michelin tyres hung together fantastically. Want to thank CompuWare, Mobil 1. I know we've got some people here from them today. You know, it's just a great, great day for all of us at Corvette Racing.
Congratulations.
Tommy! Great stuff, man.
Ah, that's a nice thing to see. Genuine joy from those guys down in the Parc Fermé area. Beautiful blue skies now. And just a reminder that in third place overall, the prototype challenge winners, Alex Popow and Ryan DL, with the victory there.